That was the strategy. That's the idea. And there's an American economist, Mr. Kenneth Rogoff, who has just published a book on it. He argues for that. This is the way and the reason for eliminating cash is for the state to have control on its citizens so they can be taxed without any, with the least amount of leakage.
Welcome to Rethinking the Dollar. Today, I'm excited to have my guest, Mr. Dan Popescu. He's a member of the Gold Broker editorial team, and today he's joining us to share his thoughts on the global economy, as well as on geopolitical events. Dan is an independent investment analyst with a focus on precious metals and their future role in our monetary system. Dan is an active voice in the alternative media world through his written commentary, as well as his own video interviews on YouTube. So Dan, welcome to Rethinking the Dollar.
Hello, glad to be here.
Well, I appreciate you taking time to sit down with me. I recently came across one of your more recent articles on goldbroker.com in regards to the India currency crisis and their war on cash and gold. And so I was definitely looking forward to getting your take on that in greater detail. But before we get into that information, I want to start off by asking you some RTD questions or Rethinking the Dollar questions. And the first question is, what comes to mind when Dan hears the words Rethinking the Dollar?
There are many interpretations of that question. The one that comes to my mind most of the time, because it's very actual. Actually, I should say actual because it started in 1971. It's the collapse of the dollar. We had for those who are not young like you, who are of a certain age like me, who I used to be around 18, 25 in 1971, 73. So I went through the collapse of the gold exchange, because it wasn't a gold standard. It was a gold exchange dollar system, the Bretton Woods system. And I had the unfortunate chance in life to go through the collapse of the US dollar that went through 1971 with the announcement and with the oil embargo in 1973, which made a dollar crisis that I had to leave. I was commuting very much between Montreal, Canada at that time, and Switzerland, France, and Italy, and found myself during the summer in Paris with American travel checks in US dollars. That's the only ones that existed at that time, and couldn't cash them. A month or 2 months before that, travel checks in US dollars were king in every cafe, every restaurant. And at that time I was a student, there were no credit cards. And even if there were credit cards, I was not allowed to them. Mm-hmm. So I had to have cash, and the safest cash was travel checks in $10, $20. And I used to, 3 months earlier, I was cashing them in every cafe and restaurant in Europe. And 3 months later, I go back to Europe because of the experience was so good. I took American Express travel checks to during my trip, only to find myself on the 13th of July, which is the day before the national holiday in France, with travel checks that nobody wanted to see. I went to the same hotel in Paris where I stayed 2 months, 3 months earlier, and had no problem. And the guy at the counter told me, "Get that garbage out of my sight."
Really?
And I thought he was joking to me because he knew me. And I realized very fast that he wasn't joking, and he made me run throughout Paris to find an official bank, which was still open on the 13th of July, just before the national holiday, to exchange my U.S. dollars. And read about 2 or 3 years ago, a famous author in finance, she had the same experience in Italy. And both of us, we were lucky. I was lucky because I had family in Europe, and I gave them the travel checks and they gave me cash. And this lady in Italy, she had cash, so she was lucky. So it was the time where nobody wanted to see the face of a US dollar.
Wow.
So that's when the whole collapse, if you want, started with Paul Volcker in the United States cutting inflation, and Ronald Reagan bring a kind of an enthusiast, kind of an illusion, I would call it today. But when Ronald Reagan came to power in 1980, was a denial, an attack on the Carter years and the Nixon years of waste, excessive debt. They put, I think, in Times Square, a timer with the debt of the United States.
Right.
So Ronald Reagan came to power promising he's going to clean that up. But it didn't happen. What happened is that his Star Wars and expenses and all that increased the debt of the United States. And they forgot about the debt, and actually author Stickman, David Stickman, who just wrote another book, Trumped, and he was at that time budget director for Ronald Reagan, and he was attracting attention to the administration that it doesn't work. We are spending like the previous administration, but we are not, there is no money. We cut taxes, that's great, but we didn't cut expenses.
Mm-hmm.
So the problem continued, and the debt expanded, and then you had George W. Bush and the war in Iraq, Afghanistan, and it exploded the debt. And we ended up in 2008 with a major financial crisis that almost collapsed everything. You know, we get accused very often, the people in the gold industry, to be what they call the gold bugs that see the end of the world, and that things might not be as bad as we pretend. But it's not just me who's, I'm not a gold bug, I just do it as a career. I don't even wear my wedding ring. I don't like, I'm not crazy about gold, but what even people like the governor of the Bank of Canada, previous governor of the Bank of Canada, and now the governor of the Bank of England, Mark Carney, said in 2011 at a speech here in Toronto that he had a section in his speech, and the print copy has the title clearly. It says, "The Minsky Moment of the international monetary system." Now, Minsky Moment is, Minsky is an economist who said that the more you push a problem, the more you kick the can into the future, the bigger the problem amplifies, and at one point when it explodes, the bigger the explosion, the bigger the impact of that event. In other words, you don't solve the problem by pushing it, you are only accumulated. And in biology, in the United States, biologists realized that by not letting fires in forests clean up the mess in the forest, the natural cycle, the more you push it, like in the Yellowstone Park, the more you push it, the more, the bigger the fire will be once every 5 or 10 years.
Yeah.
So it's better to have smaller fires than having a big one. So with the international monetary system right now, we pushed it, and Mr. Carney, what he says is that the international monetary system and the global debt is at a Minsky moment. We are very close to that explosion. So it's not a gold bug who says that.
Yeah.
And Ben Bernanke, who's the past governor, chairman of the Federal Reserve Bank in the United States, told author Jim Rickards in recently, I think it was last year, in at a conference in South Korea, that the international monetary system is incoherent. So, as you can see, and Christine Lagarde, the International Monetary System, the president of International Monetary Fund, the IMF, she also said, and they are working since the crisis in 2008, they are working to a solution, an update to the International Monetary System. So this is the way I see a resetting of the dollar. Yeah. Is in reality is that the exorbitant privilege that the dollar had for so many years, it's unsustainable and comes to the end of it, we're gonna have a reset. It's not the end of the world.
Yeah,
but there is gonna be a reset.
Okay, now watch. That was by far the most detailed and thorough explanation, because you incorporated history, your personal experience in Europe about people not really wanting the dollar, and so that leads me to my next question of the same explanation you just shared with us for the younger generation who has no clue. Based upon the things you just explained, why is it important right now, like never before, for people to take an interest in monetary matters globally, as well as how it relates to their own personal finances?
It's important because it's going to affect you in your life. United States imports a lot. Most of the products that you use in United States is imported goods from Asia, from mostly from Asia, from China, from India. All the call centers are in the Philippines, in India. So it will affect everyday life. It's not just a theoretical between some elite that deal with it. They will make the decisions, but it will affect everybody in everyday life. So it is important. North Americans for many years have been isolated with two currencies, the dollar, the Canadian dollar and the US dollar, and very close to parity to each other. The difference usually is 0.8, so it fluctuates. So they're almost equal. When you cross the border, you barely see the difference. In other countries, like in Europe, until the euro started in 2001, they had to deal with multiple currencies. So it's you have to be conscious about currencies more and more, and the international monetary system, because it will affect everybody. The dollar will collapse, and it will happen what happened to me, but not only as tourist, because I mentioned the situation. You might say, well, what does somebody in Los Angeles who never travels, what does he care about a trip to Paris? I don't care. I never go to Paris. Well, in 1973, when the explosion of prices, because of the collapse of the US dollar, all the prices of import products and oil, which is used by cars, by buses, by trains, the prices exploded. And I was a student. I was learning to fly in 1970. My flying lesson was about $12 an hour for a small plane. And all of a sudden, it went to $20, $25.
Really?
Flying, the driving became unaffordable. For young people like you who don't understand, there was a company, a car company called AMC, American American Motor Company, I think.
Right,
AMC.
I think that's right.
It went bankrupt because they didn't have small cars. They were not producing small cars, only big ones. Lucky for Ford and GM, they brought small cars from Germany and from England. They brought the Capri and the Mustang for Ford. But AMG had to create its own car. It took time. They came out with a car called the Pacer, which was the first American small car, and they lost the market to Volkswagen, to the Beetle, and to the Japanese Honda and Toyota, because Americans couldn't afford anymore the big cars. It was the price of oil. So a collapse of the US dollar for somebody who doesn't care about finance, that's what the effect is going to be. He's going to feel it in his salary.
Yeah.
He's going to feel it in his expenses. If everything is expensive, if Walmart cannot bring from China the products that we can afford on very low salaries, Keep in mind, in the United States, the so-called recovery, most of the Americans, and it's also in Canada, have to hold two jobs. And most of the jobs that have been created are minimum salary service jobs in McDonald's, in service company, restaurants. It's not manufacturing. It's not high-paying jobs. So, and you have now what they call shrinkflation. I see it already in Canada, in the United States, is that you buy the same chocolate bar, it yeah. costs still $1, but it's rather than being
the size is right now. Yeah.
It's 750.
Yeah, and also with that same concept there, shrinkflation, I wasn't aware of that particular word, but I know about the concept, but like they'll dumb down and minimize the quality of the content, such as I heard, I forgot what candy bar it is, but they, you know, they use a different form of cocoa now as opposed to the rich stuff that they used to have. So people think they're buying the same goods, but it's really not the case. But since you're in Canada, let me get your thought on this current presidential election cycle. And now that Donald Trump, or president-elect, is scheduled to begin his presidency in January, what are your thoughts about that, looking down from Canada upon, you know, his leadership ability, and can he bring the change that he's promising, and will he clean out the swamp and things like that? Or give me your thoughts on Donald Trump and, you know, what's headed for him in 2017.
I like very much. I have a problem with Donald Trump in the sense that I agree in large part with what he says, but he has the habit of contradicting himself in the same sentence. You see it right now that he came and he presented for more than a year, 2 years, all the issues and all the problems that United States has to face, facing reality that when United States is not a super rich country that it used to be, he addresses the issues very well, right on the money. But then in the same sentence, very often, he contradicts himself and he says, well, we're not going to do that. Best example is with cutting government expenses, cutting government waste. And he's right. And I agree with him. And every time he says that, I'm enthusiastic. And I say, that's it, Donald. I'm behind you. And then he says, well, we're going to triple... build new roads and borrow money. We're gonna increase the military spending. And I say, wait a minute. What are you saying? I just applauded you, and now you're cutting my enthusiasm. just this week, he announced on Twitter that he's gonna cut the 747, the Air Force One renewal, the new Air Force One. And I said, that's exactly what it takes. It's leadership from the top. You're the best, Donald. You lead by example. You preach something and you do it. He promised and he seems to be doing, not taking a salary. It's symbolic, but that's for small people. They want to see that the people at the top are taking some responsibility also. So Donald Trump said he's not going to take a salary, and that's a symbolic step. It's not a solution, but it's symbolic. It is very good what he did. He said, I'm going to cut the 747. It's a waste of money. I agree with it. What was the criticism of Americans towards Great Britain in 1944, a decadent empire who couldn't afford anymore but had a royal yacht for the queen? Okay, your country is devastated after two wars. Your country is no more an empire, and you walk around the world in a royal yacht with golden toilets. Doesn't make sense. And that was the criticism of the Americans towards the British and the French Empire and the Spanish Empire. Clean up your mess. And what is happening today? Look at the United States. They travel the president in a super jumbo jet 747, which is the modern equivalent of a royal yacht.
Yeah.
Okay? I'm a pilot. I'm son of a pilot. Most of my uncles are Air Force pilots from the Second World War, and I'm a pilot. And I can tell you, I hope no general will give me as an argument that it's for security reason that they buy a 747. I think you said you live in Detroit. You are not far from Chicago. If you are in a car and there is a fight in the streets between drug dealers or criminals, and you are in one of those stretch limousines, which one would you prefer to be in? One of those stretch limousines or in a small, for example, Beetle Volkswagen from the 1970s? I'm going to tell you, I prefer to be in the Beetle because I'm out of there in 2 seconds with the Beetle, even if it's an old car. But I'm going to be stuck with that stretch limousine, and the criminals will have time to kill me 100 times.
And you'll be a
So,
target because you'll stand out. I'm sorry, go
the
ahead.
747 is it's not even for security reason because if there is a war, by the time the president gets to the 747, it takes a long time to start that 747 to make it take off, and it's such a big elephant that everybody knows where it is. So it's not the most efficient. So it's purely for ego trip, like a royal yacht. So Donald Trump promised to cut that, and I said that's leading by example. That's the way you should do it. But then he comes with a tweet and he says, "Well, I'm just trying to negotiate the price down and get an extra chair made of gold, maybe." Well, that's not cutting expenses. That's not. So, in a way, I think Donald Trump understands the problems. I think he's the type of person who can force it on Americans. But in another way, I'm getting the impression that it's. Nothing has changed, that the people that he's surrounding himself will do about the same thing and repeat. And it comes to my conclusion that the only way it's going to happen is don't fix it until it's broken. It's going to break. And then you have no choice but then to deal with it. And that's what we've said, and I still believe it based on the information I have. I'm ready to change my mind if they show differently that this system, this international monetary system, which is incoherent, it's based on debt, and there is an excessive amount of debt, will collapse. And we are very close to collapse. It can happen this in 2017, 18, or 19. But not later than that. And that's the other way is for the global community to sit down and to find a solution to clean up that mess, but they don't seem to be interested in doing it. So in a way, I'm giving a chance to Donald Trump. I think that he understands the issues. But I get the feeling from his actions that he's the type of guy who talks a lot, but all image and no real substance. So, but let's
Yeah,
see.
we'll see. Yeah, we'll see how that goes. We'll see. It's going to be interesting heading into 2017, being that he's going to walk into a variety of world events that's going to impact our country. Now, let's get a little bit into the banking sector, currencies, precious metals, things like that. And so there's a lot of activity happening in Europe with the whole banking section there, Deutsche Bank and Monte Paschi in Italy. And so give me your thoughts on that. Will those be some things that really begin to get out of control in 2017 that might cause some problems? Because you hinted at, a collapse, things are coming to an end soon. Can those be some things that can kind of get things rolling a lot faster heading into the new year?
I don't think it will happen during the holiday season. I doubt it very much. It's not an impossibility. In nature, everything can happen. A hurricane and that can happen by surprise, and that nature, that's the way it works. But I don't think so. My speculation, my hypothesis is that the Trump balloon, the Trump euphoria will end somewhere in March, April. In April, you have the renewal of the debt ceiling in the United States. And I think that it's about that time where you're going to have some kind of a collapse of the US dollar, an increase of the price of gold beyond the 1,400.
Now, I'm sorry, you mentioned around March, April, the collapse of the dollar. Like, you know, give me your thoughts on how that, you know, arrives and what triggers it, and what does that mean, the collapse of the dollar? How does that play out?
The trigger can be anything. It's like an avalanche. It takes a snowflake to create an avalanche at the right moment, but the conditions are there. The environment, like Mr. Bernanke said, it's incoherent, unstable. The international monetary system is unstable. It takes a very little thing for it to collapse. What will be the event that will make it trigger? It could be a bank in Europe that collapses. It could be some bank institution in the United States. Long-term capital happen in the United States, not in Europe. But it had the international monetary system today, it's interlinked, it's a complex system. So once the snowball effect starts going on, we will be behind in trying to stop it. This is the problem. In physics, you had the situation with Chernobyl nuclear breakdown. And you also had it in not far from where you are. Where is the nuclear center? Long Island.
I'm not familiar.
It's a nuclear plant.
Yeah, I'm not sure where that's at. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I think it's near Chicago somewhere. There was a failure. And it wasn't as bad as Chernobyl in Ukraine, but that's the problem. Complex system, once they start, we humans end up by being behind, five, six steps behind.
Right.
So something can trigger it without us. It can even be a natural event, some catastrophic natural event. Could be an earthquake in California, which scientists, physicists like me have been expecting for quite some time, because the cycle shows that some kind of a major earthquake in California could happen. And that can trigger all kinds of economic events, hardship, like it happened in New Orleans.
Yeah.
And it can have a snowball effect. So that's a natural event. It can be a military. You see the trade wars. That's for sure. It's going to happen, but how fast it's going to escalate? It's sufficient that one side miscalculates the decision of the other one. Donald Trump seems to believe that he's the greatest negotiator in the world. But even the greatest negotiator in the world can miscalculate, like in a poker game. You miscalculate the other side, and it produces a chain of new events that you did not expect and for which you are not prepared.
All right, let's head over to the whole India situation in regards to your latest article and the whole removal of the 500 and 1,000 rupee note, and how that basically just created a surge for gold and silver, I assume, as well. Give us your thoughts on that, and give me some of your research as to what you've heard and what you've, and relate it to the whole collapse you just referenced to here in the United States. Is that something that could be paralleled as far as cash either being injected or cash being withdrawn or what? Give me your thoughts.
Well, we expected the international, Jim Rickards has written a book recently about again comes to the collapse of the international monetary system. What the people in power, if you want, the leaders, the central bankers, the governments, the G20, what are they trying to do? Because they need money, because there's so much debt, and they can't increase taxes, and they want to have to get their hands on every little bit of money. They are trying to control the currency in circulation. It's very difficult to control the money in circulation if it's physical money, if it's paper money circulating, because it's out of the control. The state doesn't know where the money flows. So they are trying to eliminate cash, paper cash, and to put everything electronically. Why? Because the banking system electronically is connected between them, and they are connected to the government. The government in Canada and in the United States, especially for little people who get a salary, your taxes are deducted directly by your company through your bank and goes into the account of the government. So for the government, it's very easy because they can switch and increase your taxes very fast without you being out of it. So finding a way out. What happens in India is that 80% to 90% of the economy functions with cash outside of the banking system. So the government has no access to that money, has no evidence of it, and cannot tax it even. So what the government of India wanted to do is to force people to stop using cash, use the banking system, so they can have access to your money, so there will be no leakages, they will get their tax money. That was the strategy, that's the idea, and there's an American economist, Mr. Kenneth Rogoff, who has just published a book on it. He argues for that. This is the way, and the reason for eliminating cash is for the state to have control on its citizens so they can be taxed without any, with the least amount of leakage. And if you want to make inflation, it's much easier, and you don't have to go through the legal system to devalue the currency. You can also stop people from using money by a switch of a button. That already happens in the United States, because the limit of how much money you can take out of your account, those limits have been pushed down constantly. So in India, because it's a cash economy, mostly it was very, very difficult. They tried it by eliminating the 500 and 1,000 notes and only keep the 2,000, but forcing everybody to exchange the old ones into the new 2,000. Unfortunately, the size of India with its large population and the fact that India is 80% cash out of the banking system, it produced chaos. And Indians are very familiar with gold. So in the first day when they introduced that measure, what happened is that Indians ran very fast to exchange their 500 and 1,000 rupees notes into gold coins, gold bullion, gold jewelry, to avoid putting it into the banking system. So it has created chaos. Now, what is the consequence for us? Is that all the world governments want to do the same thing. So they are watching carefully how successful India will be, because they want to implement it in the United States and in Europe. So that's why it's important for us too.
All right. Now, implementing that into the Western world will be something that would not be taken very lightly, very, very well. If people wake up one day and the $50 and the $100 bill is withdrawn or removed or something like that, or bank accounts are frozen. So what would that begin to look like if all of a sudden would it be a something to help the banking sector out? Because a lot of people hint at the idea of being bailed in because the banks are insolvent, or would it help fund the government? Or what would be the primary reason for it? Is it just ultimately just control everything or what?
The main objective is that the governments need money, okay, to function. So they need, they cannot print, that they printed money and it didn't work. So they need money, but in order for that, they need to have control of the currency. And if it's out of their control, they can't. So that's the objective is to have immediate access to money and to have access to even to eliminate as much as possible money that is outside of their control. Helping the banking system is not their priority, but it certainly helps the banking system, which is part of the government. Money, paper money, fiat money circulates with the permission and under the government's legal authority, if you want, through the banking system. In every country in the United States, it's through the Federal Reserve and the Treasury. In England, it's the Bank of England, the European Central Bank. So the objective is to get as much control of the money so they can tax it more efficiently. So when they increase taxes, there is no loopholes for the money to run away.
Right.
So that is the main objective of eliminating liquid money, if you want, paper money. Paper money is easier for the state because, as you saw in India, just by refusing to print new money, they handicap the population because the government prints the money. It's much more difficult with gold because the government cannot print gold, okay, physical gold or silver or copper. So humans were smart in India. When they saw that they don't print rupees anymore, they went into gold.
Mm-hmm.
And in countries who go through civil war, revolution, that's what happens. The banking system closes. There is no more liquid. So if you don't have access to foreign currencies, people start bartering real stuff. And the most marketable real stuff, it's called silver and copper. Okay? But it can go into other things. It can. I've seen it in Eastern Europe after the collapse of the system and hyperinflation. I've seen people paying the dentist with a painting. I've seen people paying with antique chairs because anything other than the money. I had the experience with my niece, my cousin, when I went to visit her, and copper wire was stolen in the house, and they left the paper money. And I said, who's going to do that? He said, and my cousin told me, copper has more value than paper money today.
Wow. He took the copper and left the paper. Interesting. Wow. Well, hey, Dan, I appreciate you sitting down with us. For those that may not be familiar with your work, give the audience a chance to follow you and to stay up to date with what you have going on. Where can they find you at? How can they find you?
Well, I have a site on YouTube, and I do a report once a month in one version in English and the equivalent same material in French. So they can search on YouTube for Dan Popescu, and they will find me. I do it usually around every 2 weeks. And I'm also on a daily basis on Twitter under Popescu Co. And there I give information much more updated, sometimes every minute, every hour, depending if it's events that happen. And I have a website. If they go on Twitter, they can also get to my website where I put links to the articles that I write for different people like goldbroker.com or others for which I write articles. So they can follow me. The fastest way is through Twitter, where I I tweet much, much faster information than on the website.
All right. Well, Dan, appreciate you sitting down. Look forward to staying in touch with you and continue to follow your work. You do a good job of covering a variety of issues. So I appreciate you for that and enjoy your day.
Thank you very much and have nice holidays.
You as well. Thank you.